Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Murder, Death, Kill Club Facebook group tribute to Danny Havoc. The wrestling world suffered a serious loss when a 100% professional in and outside of the ring, Danny Havoc, passed away earlier this week, and we're feeling it all through professional wrestling as a whole, not just in the deathmatch scene, but even hearing words from people on televised programs saying how much Danny meant to them. And some of those people who Danny meant a lot to and who meant a lot to him will be joining us here tonight. We are live. First, I will be joined by Larry Legend, announcer extraordinaire, a tremendous professional. I will be joined by CZW owner DJ Hyde, and I will be joined by Nation of Intoxication member Connor Claxton. Good evening, gentlemen. How are you all doing?
Hey, Connor.
Good old Scotty.
Can everybody hear me? Am I coming in clear?
Yeah.
I can hear you.
Only hear you. I think that's right. I don't know.
I can hear you. Can you guys hear me?
Yep. Okay. So it looks like we're ready to roll here. We're going to start with Larry and work our way down. Larry, why don't you tell us your first impressions of Daniel Tiberius Havoc, the first time you met him and how that came about? Larry, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Was that a question for me? I'm sorry.
Yes, absolutely. If you could tell us about your first experience with Danny and how you had met him and what that experience was like, your first impressions of him.
Okay, I Wait, was that for me or Connor?
No, that's for you, Larry. We're starting with you and we're going to work our way down.
Okay, so Scotty, I'm having a hard time hearing you. But I imagine that you asked me like my experience about meeting Danny Havoc and what it was like. Okay. I couldn't make that out either. But I'm just gonna talk about Danny real quick. So I met Danny when I first came to Combat Zone Wrestling as a member of Blackout. I was the personal ring announcer for Ruckus and Joker and Eddie Kingston in that stable. And I remember when I first came to CZW, I kind of really stayed close to Blackout. I really didn't kind of mingle with anyone else because I didn't know any of those individuals. And just like I said in my Hall of Fame induction ceremony, like CZW was a little intimidating.
I can't hear anybody else. So Larry's talking right now, but I can't.
Yeah, I can't hear. Like,
well, Scotty keeps talking intermediately and replying.
I can hear. So I think Potter saying, "Oh, there's DJ."
I hope not.
Hey, Deej. Wait. Okay. I wonder why I can't hear anyone. I can hardly hear anyone. But anyway, I'm going to continue my story about Danny. So when I first came to Combat Zone, I really stayed to myself. It was intimidating to be around people like Necro Butcher, Insane Lane, Brain Damage, DJ Hyde, like individuals that I probably would not really associate with or call my friends. But I distinctly remember that the first person of the Combat Zone family that was non of color that really kind of embraced me and welcomed me and, you know, gave me that encouragement and pat on the back was Danny. And that was from the very first appearance in CZW that I had, like way back in 2006, I believe around the time that he was just kind of making a name for himself as well. In Combat Zone Wrestling and the ultra-violent underground division, he was one of the first folks that like really let me know that I belong or made me feel that I belonged and that I was welcomed. And he gave me so much encouragement and always went out of his way to tell me that I did a really good job with his introduction, and also give me, you know, things, you know, to embellish, you know, including his title. Like, you know, as we've been throwing up those hashtags, RIP Danny Havoc, you've been seeing a lot of people refer to him as Daniel Tiberius Havoc. Well, that was all him. And that was all something that he gave me to kind of have fun in my role up there with him. And I appreciated so much that he thought that much of me to, you know, embrace me and welcome me into Combat Zone and also have fun with me while I did my job.
Very cool. DJ, can you tell us about your first experiences with Danny?
Well, first time I met Danny was his basically his first day in CZW. He showed up at the CZW Wrestling Academy. I think he already had a conversation with John at the time, with Zandig. And basically, I remember him saying that I'm going to be the biggest deathmatch superstar ever. He proceeded to tell me a story about how he was suplexing a sheep. And like, he was serious about it. I never really, you know, kind of understood. Like, I was like, what? He was suplexing a sheep back in his on the farm in Iowa. And he came out here with his wife at the time. I don't know if other people know that Danny's been married more than once. And just like this young kid, you know, a little wild. And I kind of just remember going, all right, let's see what happens with him. And then probably the better part of the next couple of years, we're just killing each other in the ring every month at CZW.
Very cool. Connor, what about your first experiences with Danny?
I had it with a guardrail. Was
tryout.
And he was in a moment where he's telling me he couldn't breathe and he needed a break. And then Danny Havoc walked and he runs up to Grant
telling me he's out of breath. And then my next favorite one was, and this is where I really, really got to know Grant, was a fucking pedophile who I won't name asked me if I wanted to drive.
Yeah, no one really can hear each other.
And I can hear you, Larry.
Kind of sucks.
But anyway, I drove him and Devin Moore and a couple other people. I was just a student at the time, and I drove him to Detroit and
makeshift rap concert in Detroit. And so we go to leave, and the one wrestler, I forget who it was there, and he's like, "Man, can you go tell Devin Moore and Chuck to hurry up? They were taking their dear old sweet time." And I went back in to go tell them, and I ended up just hanging out and drinking more with them. And that's when Grant put the idea, he like just mentions like, "Oh man, you could be a future Nation member." And I remember when he said that to me, I'm like, man, that would be so fucking cool. That would be the best thing that could ever happen to me. And then when it actually happened, he made me have to take shit.
And you had wrestled him in the Deathmatch Trial Series as well, hadn't you?
I mean, that was like maybe like another year later. This is when I was like just a little young boy student working the guardrail. I ended up wrestling Grant about a year and a half later, I think. It was the whole Wrench Chronicles, the whole Nation of Intoxication Deathmatch Trial Series was completely his idea. He got me my start. He brought me to the main roster. I'm sure I would have made it there eventually, but he's the reason it happened so soon.
Very cool. And a lot of what's been coming out the last couple of days have been his drawings, how he would create these really intricate weapons and instruments of torture and destruction.
Oh yeah, I have a couple of pages of Danny Havoc drawings. He would email me them a lot, usually in the middle of the night, But yeah, I have a couple folders full of Danny Havoc drawings, and what's great for those is like there's some of the he would do so much. He would always be doing his drawings of deathmatch gimmicks and stuff. So like when I have a match coming up and I need to think about something, I pull those out all the time. Just like okay, what does Danny Havoc have for me now?
What's kind of your favorite?
If it makes anybody feel better, Danny Havoc will be living on in my deck of his drawing for inspiration.
Lay.
What was kind of your favorite of those late night gimmicks that he would send you? Are there any that stick out in your mind that the first time you saw it, you kind of got surprised?
The one that's kind of like my favorite is the mousetrap, which there's several variations and ways to do it. I've tried to duplicate it myself a couple of times. It worked out okay. Nothing, not as good as what Grant had initially planned. But it's essentially two pieces of two boards of some sort, usually wrapped in barbed wire or carpet strips or something like that. And it's usually just opened up with like a little mouth and something holding them open, and you get thrown in, and then the two barbed wire doors close in on you. The mousetrap's always been my favorite.
DJ, was there a favorite gimmick that you had from the papers that Danny would bring you with ideas for contraptions?
So, for his contraptions, me and him, he used to work like a day job at our t-shirt vendor. And guy's name was Tony. So Grant, when you walked into what was defined as his office in that building, he would have these ideas on the wall from these conversations we would have, and then he would just come up with stuff. There were so many things that we had. Most of it, though, is like stuff that me and him did. Grant was one of the most selfless individuals you'll ever meet. And you know, if you talk to like his friends, like one thing, like I think at one point, I don't know if Dev is still on here, but like we tried to make him win the CZW title, and he refused, you know. And when he would come up with these contraptions, it would be like, well, you could do this or you could do that.
Oh, yeah. He,
like,
he would never touch that belt.
Yeah. I mean, my favorite, though, of all these things, he did this match with Sammy Callahan that was called the Devil Wears Prada Deathmatch. And he had these ideas to make this board with upside down heels. And I was just like, that's fucking weird. Like, why? And then, like, when I saw it, like, he's, like, sitting there gluing these heels on this big, you know, sheet of plywood. And it just, it was, like, one of the coolest things ever. I was like, this looks like it's going to hurt. I'm going to take it. It was just such a cool thing that he had a draw. Like, that, had like, beautiful heel made. It was crazy.
Is that Ray? What's up, Ray?
That's awesome.
What's up, Dev? Devin Moore and Drew Blood joining us here now. How are you guys?
It's Connor. You can't tell it's Connor.
You look like Jesus.
You look like Jesus. You look like Connor.
Dev, you want to tell us about the first time you met Danny Havoc?
Oh, man. The first time I met Danny Havoc, I was seeing Drake. Drake was staying in his apartment. And I had no idea who they were. And I'm sitting in the living room smoking weed with Drake. And he's like, it's all right, man. It's cool. And Grant's wife just walked in and stared at me like, what's this guy? So it was awkward. But we got along after that.
I believe it. Do you have a favorite gimmick that he designed or contraption that he made?
Broken scaffold match. That was brilliant.
Anything that scaffold match was really good. What are let's start with Devin. We'll go down the line the other way. What are some of your favorite Danny Havoc matches and why?
Oh, man, there's a lot of them. Me and him and King of the Death matches flying off the scaffold. There's too many, man. There's a lot. Me and him did the scaffold match in Germany. It was a lot of fun.
I like that match a lot.
Him and Drew Gasai, I love. Him and Lucky in Florida. There's a lot of good ones.
Connor, what about you? What are some of your favorite Danny Havoc matches?
I mean, I've had two or three matches with Danny Havoc, but my favorite's obviously got to be the Panes of Glass match from the Nation of Intoxication Trial Series.
That was good.
We had the panes of glass that had the black like trim on them. So like right in the beginning of the match, I threw Danny Havoc backwards into one that was in the corner, and when he went through it, the frame still had some glass stuck in it and sliced open under his bicep, and the fat was coming out.
So, oh, I remember that.
I'll never forget that. And then I was bleeding a lot that match, and I managed to drive myself home, and I walked into my bathroom when I got home, and then I passed out right there. And luckily I made enough noise, my dad found me, and he was trying to get me to go to the hospital, but I was like sweating my balls off because I was like overheating weird from losing blood or something. I'm like, just turn the air conditioning on.
Oh, your back was bad.
Yeah, I went to bed and I woke up stuck to my mattress. It was gross. I passed out in my bathroom, put a hole in my wall because of that match. But yeah, that's probably why it's one of my favorite matches with Danny Havoc ever. I got the other second best match I had with Danny Havoc was in Milwaukee at one of his retirement shows. And I got a nice, nice hole in my leg. So every time I see that nice, nice hole in my leg, I get to be reminded of Danny Havoc.
Yeah, I got a couple scars that remind me of him.
There is. Where's my camera? That one right there.
I remember that.
DJ, what were some of your favorite matches with Danny?
Oh, man. I think me and Grant,
when you hit him in the head,
Danny had wrestled each other so many times earlier in his career that it was just – it was like a blur for a while. But my favorite matches so we did a tour of Japan, and it was Grant's first tour. And we did a tag match in Portland, and it was me, him, and Drake, a six-man against Yuji Kobayashi, Abdullah Kobayashi, Yuji,
You cocksucker!
God damn it, I can't even get out of there. And Numazawa. And I just remember thinking about, like, we were all there, we signed the wall, we did the thing, there was Black Jeep. I think Drake put up a photo of us at the bathhouse recently, which find that on my Facebook or whatnot, somewhere there. And we're in these, like, robes the night before that are, like...
Yeah, that was the best. Like,
yeah, it was kind of crazy. And then we did this crazy six-man Corgan with, like, twos. There was, like, a shark cage and all this stuff. And Grant was so adamant of just going off the scaffold, and then, or like not the scaffold, but like there's a balcony in Corgan Hall, and like Psy was doing it in the main event, and I think he was wrestling Ito, and it was just for their Big Japan title, so it was kind of like a weird thing. But I remember that match so fondly because I remember when we all came back. Like, I remember Drake all, man, we just played a at Corgan Hall, man. And, like, just giving him the Drake, what we all have, the old Drake, crazy stuff that Drake does. And, like, Grant just looking at him, like, it's very rare that you would see Grant just be like, man, I'm really proud of this. Like, you would see that. And I remember looking at Grant, and Grant had that, like, this is fucking cool. You know what I'm saying? He's fucking head to toe covered in blood. I think he had like a thumbtack basketball hit him in the face or something too. And it was like, you know, it was just like passed in his head. And it was just like a weird thing. And I just remember that moment and thinking, man, this was like the coolest match we've ever done. And, you know, and there's some other stories that go along with that, but we'll get to them later. But that was probably my favorite thing. Other than, you know, I dropped a guardrail on his head. Yeah, constantly reminds
he also
me of
beat
that.
You with a
that's
bucket.
That's his favorite. That's his
remember
favorite
that, DJ?
Yeah.
DJ, remember the bucket?
To be honest, no, I don't.
Yeah, he beat the shit out of you with it.
Yeah, I remember. I vaguely
That was the receipt for the guardrail, bud.
I got a lot of those. But that...
Those guardrails are heavy.
Yeah, that was definitely...
Oh, the big solid steel ones suck.
Yeah, they're the ones that we were using.
The TOD ones.
Yeah, Nick Cage powerbombed me on one. It didn't move.
Yeah, but that moment was just something that, like, to me, was a big deal. So, my favorite program.
All right, so I believe we have the voices of Larry Legend and Scotty Vortex. Can you guys hear everybody?
Scotty on?
Somewhere. Like, I can't hear anything. People need to shut up.
I can't.
Where's
really
Scotty
hear
and Larry at?
They're in the stream. We just gotta.
There's a dickhead behind me.
Why do you look so angry?
Oh, there's only four
people
on.
Why's your head so big, DJ?
Listen, don't you read the internet? I'm all about putting myself over. Come on, Connor. It's actually true.
Connor beats you with dildos all the time.
You're 0 for 3, and I've never taken a laugh.
Yeah, we taught you well, Connor.
Grant took that thing many, many times.
Yeah, I took that fucking Larry.
All right, we're going to be joined at 10 p.m. by Scotty Vortex and Larry Legend. DJ, can you give us a Danny Havoc story that you enjoy very much before we swap out our guests?
So I'm going to tell this Danny Havoc story because it's the best story ever. So and Devin probably knows the story even though he wasn't with us. Same tour that we were on. We were in fucking Yokohama. And we're in some,
oh, I know this,
some shitty ass fucking bar. So we all went out with Daisuke Sekimoto. He got everybody. Like, he had like a friend. He took it to like what he calls a girls bar. Fucking great time. You know what I'm saying? So I know I have to go and talk to like the office the next day and get up. So I go back to my hotel. And you know, I go in my room, and the room's like the size of, like, the whole room is like the size of somebody's bathroom house. It's a shoebox. I'm going to sleep, and about like 2 hours later, Drake is knocking on my door, and he's crying, and he's like, "I lost Drake." And I'm like, "What do you mean?" He told me he's going to live his life in Japan. So I'm waking up everybody we know. Jesus with us. Like, we're fucking searching the sea.
Paige, I can't find him.
I can't find him, man. And, like, we're freaking
He's
out.
He's fucking lost, Paige. I can't
we
find him.
We literally are out till 6 in the fucking morning looking for him. We come back in. He's passed out in the fucking elevator. He's the fucking worst shit I've ever heard the whole fucking time. And, like, and Drake's like, "Oh, man!" And, like, hugging Grant, like, he's just all he's fucking drunk out of his mind.
Yo, DJ. Remember when me and Moxie got him on the plane to Germany?
Oh, that was fucking awesome too. That was a
classic.
Alright, I think we got time for one more. Go ahead.
It's nuts. It was like some of these stories we
me
have.
Me and Moxie got him on the plane.
They weren't letting
him on.
How we
did it?
What happened?
I was aggressive. I'm like, "You're letting him on the plane," and Moxie's like, "Come on, man, just let him on."
Connor, you have one more good Danny Havoc story for us before we have to swap out guests?
Always willing to punch me in the face.
Yeah, dude, it's a quick one, too. The first time I ever did the barbed wire trampoline, I actually, first person I always messaged when I don't have things quite figured out myself in the physics of these things, is I messaged Danny Havoc. And I'm like, "Hey, man, I'm doing the barbed wire trampoline. I'm going to wrap it like this. I'm trying to think of doing this move. Like, what do you think?" And what's funny about this is the fact that Danny Havoc only knows how to text and not. So when you get a text from Danny Havoc, it's going to take 4 to 5 minutes just to read one text message.
Oh, yeah.
So it was funny that the only thing he texted me was, "Tuck your chin."
That's fucking great.
That's a great reply.
Yeah.
That's great. All right, guys. Thank you so much for joining us in the first part of the Danny Havoc tribute show. We'll be keeping this going till about 10:30, 11 o'clock, so be sure to stick around and be in the comments and speak about Danny with us.
Scotty, thanks for having us on, man. And anybody watching, we all love Grant. So we hope you do too. At some point, we're going to be able to go out and show people just how much.
But thank you guys. Thank you guys.
We all love Grant and hate TJ Hyde.
That's true too.
It's what Grant wanted.
Well, Connor will also tell you about Connor and him throwing darts at cardboard cutout DJ. Awesome.
That was our favorite pastime. We had a big cardboard cutout DJ.
I used to sit here and have to watch it. It was the worst, dude. It is what it is. All right, thank you, Scotty. Thank you for all you guys who checked us out.
Thank you, guys. Peace.
Scotty disappears. I'm like, there's Larry. There's right. Everybody.
Hi, Larry.
There's a Drew Blood behind me.
Hi, Larry. Hey, Drew. I love you, Drew. I love you, Dev. I love you, Scotty. I love you, Scotty.
Love you too, bro.
Yeah, bro.
Before we Scotty continue, got the hair slicked back and shit?
No, I cut it.
Oh my God!
I know.
Oh my God!
He looks like a corporate.
Now I'm gonna be able to tell
your
girlfriend for you now.
Can everybody hear before we keep this rolling?
Yeah.
We're all good. We could all hear. All right, Larry, you were telling us about your first experience with Mr. Daniel Tiberius Havoc before the connection got a little wonky. So why don't you tell us about that?
Sure. I just wanted to say that, you know, like when I first came to CZW, it was very white, you know, like other than Blackout, other than like, you know, Nell and Claude and Joker, like it was a pretty much predominantly white locker room.
Hey, Joker's half white.
Right?
Joker was just labeled a bad motherfucker. Nobody cared what anybody was, white or black or whatever.
Exactly. That's
he was beating the shit out of him. Don't
that's
fuck
what
with
Danny helped me see. Danny helped me see exactly what you said, you know, Drew, is that it wasn't about white and black. Like, all of the shit that's going on right now with people judging one another, it didn't matter. It didn't matter.
Looks good on you, Scott.
Danny was the first one to, like, kind of, like, be like, bro, you're good at what you do. You're one of us. Because all of us are good. So, fuck all that shit at the door and come be brothers. And, you know, that meant a lot to me when I first started coming around for someone to look like him, not really looking like someone that I would, like, chop it up with. You know, he really didn't look like my people. Well, the fro did him a lot.
The fro was the best.
Like, when I first started to come around, he had the huge fro. So I was like, this guy kind of, like, you know, I fucks with him, you know. But he really extended that olive branch as, like, the first person that wasn't, like, from Blackout to be like, you know, come on in here. You're with us. You know, you're one of us. So fuck that shit. So that was my first impression of him, and it meant so much to me then, and it means so much to me now that I won't be able to tell him that face to face.
Oh man,
100%. Scotty, can you tell us about your first time meeting Danny? How that went?
Yeah, my first time. It was in January of 2007. And I came out to do my first CZW show. He's my first ever opponent in CZW. And at the time, I hadn't saw a lot of his work, you know. And when you're making your debut on the East Coast, it's like make it or break it time. You know, you either got to shine or they're going to eat you alive. So I was like paranoid, like, man, I don't really know this cat. Like, I really need to do something great. And then when I get there, he's got all these crazy ideas. I remember he told me about he wanted to take a flare bump from the top rope to the outside through a sheet of glass that was propped on the apron and the guardrail with nothing else underneath it.
Yes, just top rope.
And he was so calm and nonchalant about it, just like, yeah, I want to do this. And I'm like, all right, dude, if that's what you want to do. And, man, I mean, I couldn't have asked for a better first opponent. He, you know, Grant was so innovative, and he wanted to put everyone else over. He wanted to make whoever he was wrestling look great, you know, and that's – I mean, I couldn't have asked for a better opponent. And, you know, like, we instantly clicked, you know, inside and outside of the ring from that moment on. And, you know, I'm glad to have known him as long as we did. And, you know, it sucks, obviously, that, you know, he's gone. But, like, you know, I always cherish, like, the time we spent together and the memories we made. And You know, I'm just
telling Chuck, Scotty, one of my favorite Grant matches is you and him, TOD Finals, the light tube, dude. That was one of the best fucking matches I've ever seen, man.
Thank you, man. You know, Grant was actually my first ever TOD opponent, and he was my last ever TOD opponent, too. So that's, I mean, that's
pretty, oh, my God, he was, wasn't he?
Yeah.
I forgot about that. Yeah, that match was awesome.
He was sliced to shit. You had a little nick in your back.
Oh, no, dude. Dan, remember the moonsault or the guardrail, dude? Dan, Grant hit the moonsault and guardrail. I was like, oh, my God.
I think that was the only time Grant ever got mad at me. And I deserved
it. Oh, he was mad, too.
Oh, I know he was.
I used to get that. He'd say, I'm going to punch you in the fucking face. I'm like, why? What the fuck matter?
Yeah, I love you, Drew, but I'm going to punch you in the fucking face. That's what he gets all done.
So we're just kind of celebrating the memory of Danny Havoc, exchanging stories, talking about the type, not only the type of person he was in the ring as an innovator and as a ring general, but also outside of the ring as a human being. Do you guys have any interesting stories about Danny, maybe whether it involves a match with you, Scotty, or Larry, maybe a situation that you two got yourselves in together? Some hijinks. I know it wouldn't be out of the ordinary.
Plead the fifth.
Yeah, Danny and I got into hijinks because, like, we really admired one another.
Probably, you know, documented somewhere.
Looking back on things, it's like, you know, we had a great admiration for one another. So when we weren't doing our thing, like me as an announcer and him as a wrestler, I'm talking like a Nichols Tavern. Danny would always like
good old Nichols.
Yeah, he'd want to carouse with me, you know, by the bar, and maybe some carousing in the bathroom, you know.
Oh yeah, you know, Larry, remember the time you came in? It was like me, Marvin, and Grant. And you're just like, is there room for one more? And like, you? Marvin just like looks all angry. He's just like, yes, Larry, all calm.
You were there? I don't even remember you being there, Deb. Oh, but I was there. Remember that story, you know?
I was there.
You know,
so, you just come bombarding in.
Oh, yeah, it was all of us. It was all four of us in that tiny ass little bathroom.
This tiny ass bathroom.
Yeah, so that was one of the that's one of the mini hijinks I got in with him. But one thing I want to mention, like Danny, about that admiration, like he would always give me like things to say. Like I remember when Jun Kasai came in to fight him, it was in a Ragnarok and Roll glass crush death match, and I can still say that. I can still say that verbatim.
I can't say that.
Yeah, Ragnarok and Roll glass crush death match, and the reason I can say that is because Danny like made sure. He made sure that when I went out there to announce it, that that's what I called it. And then on top of that, he told me a little bit about Ragnarok. Like, he told me about Norse mythology and, like, the Odin, the god.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Odin. Like, he started, like, telling me all this shit as I'm just, like, you know, trying to get everyone's info. But looking back on it, it was like he was a teacher. Yeah, like, he was really super intelligent, but he would never, like, talk down to you. He would just, like, like Necro never talks down to you either. They're both super smart, you know, but like
they would enlighten you,
and it was so easy to follow them and listen to both of those men, you know. And yeah, I just remembered Grant took his time with me, from welcoming me into the combat zone as being a person of color to, like, you know, taking his time with making sure I had more and more to say to add to, you know, his intro. And here's another thing, Scotty, I know I was in and out, but you mentioned, like, you know, how calm and, like, you know, kind of like almost cold Grant was. Like, he kind of like, you know, there wasn't a lot of, like, you know, he wasn't
all he that didn't show his emotions.
Right. But I'll tell you this much, and I've been watching a lot of my intros of him over the past couple days. When I used to say his name, when I got to the point that I was given his intro in the ring, there would be so much life. He would jump up in the air and pump his fist.
Oh, yeah.
And like, you know, like, have that moment with me. Like, that's right. I'm Danny fucking Havoc, and Larry Legend just announced me, you know? And I just am so sad that I'm never going to get to have those little moments with him anymore, you know? It's like, and I didn't even really recognize them when they were going on because you think you're always going to be doing that type of stuff, but I just am so happy that I got to perform with him. I'm so happy that I got to perform with him on that stage because he's hands down one of the greatest wrestlers, out of fuck deathmatch, just wrestlers out there, and an inspiration to me, to keep doing what I do. And
he didn't think so. He didn't think so at all.
Yeah, he never thought he was either, man.
He didn't think he was good at all.
Me and Masada yelled him all the time.
All the stuff he'd do where he'd, like, lace the light tubes behind your neck and then do the dragon suplex, like, or do a tilt-a-whirl. And like
I hate light tubes, and I love taking that.
Yeah, God, he knows that. He'd do a tilt-a-whirl and like have the tube behind your back, so that when you went down on his knee, like that
was my go-to.
Saw anyone do, you know? And he was one of the greatest, bro. One of the greatest. And every time I saw him in a match, like if I saw him in a match, I knew it was going to be good. I can't think of like a bad match.
Larry. In defense, when you announce anybody, we get hyped. As soon as you tell our name, we get in the zone.
That's very true. It's also very true.
I mean, that's really and if to take it back to like kind of what I think Danny would really appreciate with like his appreciation for Viking, you know, Viking culture. Like when I come out there and I do my announcement, that's like me blowing that horn. That's like me blowing your horn. Of your tribe about to go into war. And like, you know, I want to give you guys goosebumps because I know what you're about to do is going to hurt like fucking shit. I know this shit is going to tear your bodies up. So like, I want to like give you that last like fucking.
Oh, I love it, dude.
You know, or whatever, you know, like before you go out there. And it meant so much to me.
That TOD that you announced the four-way or whatever, man. I was being Masato got so excited when you showed up. We're like, yeah, Larry's got us. DJ just was like, okay. Didn't have a choice.
And that's the thing. That me giving what I give, that started right from, like, Danny at the beginning, like, being, like, always telling me that I was doing a good job. He would just go out of his way to find me and be like, not even his introduction, like, Ruckus. He'd be like, yo, I love the way you announced Claude out there, like, you know, all that stuff you said was like just fire. He just was a great human being, man.
You're doing the extravaganza last year, Larry.
I know. So
he was so happy.
So you know what? I want to say this. Like Grant and Devin, you and I, we talk like every once in a while. We'll check in, and I every once in a while, more rare than you, Danny and I would check in and. You know, Danny and I kind of had our own, like, thing going on with GCW and GCW management and, you know, kind of, like, not really feeling as welcome. And I remember, you know, he was the one that reached out to me that was like, I want you to do the Deathmatch Extravaganza. He was the one that was like, I really would like to bring you in for this. And, you know, after having, like, leaned on his shoulder a little bit about how I was feeling, you know, he kind of like lifted me up even more, like bringing me in. Like I don't think of myself as like a star or anything like that. I'm just Larry, you know. But
you're more over than half the fucking locker rooms.
Well, they really kind of anchored that first time on Fight TV. It was like I was waiting in the back and I was realizing, oh shit, this is Maddie's, this is Maddie's first Fight TV deal. This is a major deal. And Danny made sure that I was a part of it. You know, and it's funny, I just was watching that footage, you know, and, you know, I get in the ring and me and Matt, we give each other like, kind of like, hey, brother, you know,
and then
I give that to Danny, but I can't help but hug him. I can't help but go in and just embrace him. And that, you know, in the moment, you know, we're doing our show and everything, but I had to just embrace my brother, you know, because I knew he was the reason I was there to kind of inspire me to keep doing what I'm doing, you know? And I'm sorry I never got to let him know how great of a wrestler I thought he was, but you can't find a bad Danny Havoc match. And when I first came around, he was like, to me, he was like a marquee guy. If Danny was on the CZW show, Ultra Violent Underground, Nation of Intoxication, whatever it was, if Danny was doing some shit, Thumbtack Jack came in to fight him. Masada came in to fight him. Like it was like, he was our guy. He was our guy, you know. So
yeah, he was. I mean, when I came in, Scotty and Danny were the top guys. Drake, like,
yeah,
you know, and they loved to hate me, and then you know it went full circle. Turned me face to help Danny Havoc, and that was it. I helped Scotty and Danny at one time, and that was it. Instant face.
Yeah, it's it's wild to me to see how you guys like kind of like just like how I'm talking about how Danny built me up, like seeing him kind of get Connor ready, get Joe Gacy. I feel Joe Gacy really took a turn when he did that Deck the Halls death match with Danny Havoc. I think that that's really when people were like, oh shit, Joe. You know what I mean? Like, Joe was GNC, Gacy and Cologne.
Grant was selfish. Dude, he was not selfish, man.
Yeah, I know.
He did everything to make other people look good.
He was a giver. He was a giver. He was a giver. And, like, the fact that he didn't even think he was all that great is just a testament to, like, that type of human being, you know? And I'm glad I got all my tears out, you know? I can't listen to Hungry Like the Wolf, you know, without my face getting all scrunched up and just thinking about how I won't hear his voice and I won't hear that song. I won't hear that song anymore, you know?
I wouldn't go that far.
Yeah, well, I won't call him out. I won't call him out, you know? So it's like I just have been sad, you know?
Last night, this morning was the first time I slept since Sunday.
I know you. Well, the last time that I saw Grant, if I ever saw him, it was with you.
Yeah. It sucks. Like I went and saw Tremont Sunday night, stayed with him. I slept, and that's this morning at 7, I passed out till like 1. This is the first time I slept since then.
How's Maddie doing?
Maddie's good. He was running class tonight.
Okay, so he's doing stuff. Good.
Yeah, you need to come back H2O. And Scotty, we're gonna get your ass back out here too.
Yeah. Yeah, man, I'd always tell Grant that he's my personal favorite deathmatch wrestler. You know what I mean? I like Larry was saying, he couldn't have a bad match, man. He just, no matter who he was in there with, no matter if he was doing death matches or regular matches, he was great, man.
I got one for you. I remember it was a TOD and it was a three-way. It was Wax, Thumbtack Jack, and Danny. Semi-final.
Oh, when Wax broke his shoulder.
Yeah, well, not only that, Wax knocked himself out. Wax was fucked up. And
that was when Nikki got cut.
Yeah, that was Nikki almost died. But during that match, I don't think Wax
enjoyed Ryan Slater.
towards the end of it, I don't think Wax really was with it. And if you watch the end of that match, you can see Danny kind of like take control.
Oh yeah,
and kind of like you kind of position Wax to get the fuck out of the way, because you know it the match had gone on for so long, and looking back on that, like that's what I mean about how he was so good, like and also you know, educating me like about the origins of matches. Like I remember once him and Sammy had like a Caribbean spider box
and
shit. And, like, you know, he was telling me about it, and he was like, yeah, Larry, it's an old FMW gimmick. I didn't know what that was, but I remember a fan, when I went to announce that match, a fan yelled at me. He was like, what the fuck is that? And, like, I said to the fan right in the ring, it's an old FMW gimmick. And fucking, I said it just like Danny had said it to me, and I remember a guy was like, you're right, Larry! You know, like, and, like, it was like, you know, so he was just, like, always, like, he never was like setting anyone up to like mess up. Like he wasn't like he was a builder upper. Like,
oh yeah, he wasn't. I mean? Yeah. Like,
so
yeah,
a general, real G.
Yeah, at Tangleweb 4, when I cut my hand up real bad, severed my tendons.
Yeah.
Grant
was a bad day.
Yeah, well, Grant was super smashed, right? But he insisted on driving me to the hospital.
Yeah, I know.
He didn't want nobody else to do it. So I was like, all right.
I hurt my back. I couldn't walk. Yeah. I was laying in the back, oh, shit.
Yeah, yes, I told him, well, let's.
I don't think I've ever been more scared for anyone than that show, because that glass that they were using for that show wasn't like breaking like the glass that it was like breaking in huge fucking shards. You know,
right. Scotty, remember Cage of Death that year? Me and Brig and Ego, we went outside with the paint and threw the fucking weight through it, and DJ got mad. We were like, make sure you bought the right shit, dude. You ain't fucking weak, because ain't another hospital trip happening.
Hell yeah. Well, Grant drove me to the hospital, right? And he drove me right up front, and there was only one spot, and you would have had to parallel park in it. But Grant said, fuck this, and he drove straight in between the two cars. I mean, like, half his car was on the fucking sidewalk.
Oh, he didn't care.
you know, did we get out? And some dude's like, you can't fucking park like that. He's like, fuck you, my friend's hurt. Right. So he took me in the hospital, and he sat there with me the whole fucking time, man. Like, that's just, that's
who I remember, was. Man.
Yeah, he just wanted to help everybody out, man.
Dude, that's the way he was. I mean, I remember I almost killed him at Carnage Cup the one year in Alabama. And he looked back at me. He's like, don't let me die in Alabama, Chucky. And I'm just like, scared to death. Like, fuck, man, don't say that to me. Yeah. I would have took the match home. He's just like, I didn't want you to. So I can tell you I was hurt. I'm like, yeah, you're an asshole. Meanwhile, he's almost bleeding to death.
All right, guys, this has been a wonderful discussion. We do have a couple more guests who are waiting to get on and pay tribute to the late, great Daddy Havoc, Devin Moore, Scotty Vortex, Liar Legend. From the bottom of my heart and everybody watching along, thank you so much for sharing, for sharing your stories and joining us and helping us celebrate the life of Danny Havoc. I think we all spent enough time being sad. It's time to celebrate.
That's right.
Yeah, this was good.
Yeah,
well
thanks,
said, Scotty. Thanks. Yeah, thanks for bringing us on, man. This felt very good. Thank you for letting me get all this out.
Vortex, Larry, message me.
I will, yes, Scotty. I miss you, bro. I want to see you, bro. And your daughter is beautiful. You know, we got to link up, bro. I'm
for
glad
sure,
you're tonight, man.
For sure. I love you, Larry.
Love you too, bro.
Love you, Dev.
Guys, thank you.
Thank you.
Yo,
joy to be right now. Dysfunction, how are you, sir?
I'm good. I heard Dev's voice. That was an instant pop. Yo, cut.
And Madman Pondo. Pondo, how are you doing this evening?
I'm doing great, but I think I'm doing something wrong because I still see Scotty, Larry, and Devin Moore.
I see them also. I don't see Madman.
I actually believe we are the ones who are live looking at the stream because I actually see Scotty Vortex, I see Dis, and I see Pondo.
Well, I'm
so
the worst.
Yeah, it
I'm
says
the worst
I'm live,
fucking computer guy you could ever think of. So probably
it's all right. We're all bad at it, but we'll get it figured out while we can. So what we're doing tonight is we're telling some stories. We're remembering the life of the great Danny Havoc. As we've said, not just a great deathmatch wrestler, but a great professional wrestler, a great person. And when we bring the guests on, the first thing that we've asked is your first experience with Danny Havoc. So, Pondo, we'll start with you, and then we'll go to Dis. But what can you tell me about your first time meeting Danny?
I was there with the thumb, with the promo for the thumb, and he had that afro and shit. And I really didn't know that much about him. But I guess he knew shit about me, and he come over to me, and he said, you think I need to go to the hospital? You think I need stitches? I said, nah. And he goes, yeah, you're probably fucking right. And then we always talked about that every time. He was like, I was going to go get stitches, but thank God Pondo was there to talk me out of it, which I really didn't even know him that well. I was just like, nah, you'll be good. Stitches cost money. Tape costs dollars, you know? So
yeah,
that's the way I looked at it, and that's what I told Danny.
Dis, what about your first experience meeting Danny?
Man, I believe my first time meeting him was for King of the Death Matches. Like me, Toby Klein, and a very, very young Daniel Havoc in a triple threat. I'm pretty sure I don't remember much about our first meeting aside from wrestling and having a good time, to give you a specific story on that first one. But, you know, he legit became like one of my favorite people in the business, you know. Definitely one of my friends in the business from that weird encounter. I believe Toby Klein stabbed me with a fucking tube in the tummy. That match was crazy. I want to say he'd only been in the business fucking very shortly for that one.
I was actually going to bring up Pondo and Dis. You guys are both professional wrestling promoters, and you do have very specific eyes for talent. Can you guys tell me when was the moment that maybe you saw something that Danny had done, or you had been involved in a match with him where you knew that he got it and you knew he was going to be something big?
Well, I always liked the way Danny would bump in something, but then not really sell that he was hurt later. So when we did, I brought in Ryuji Ito, and Danny had said something to me about he wanted to get an opportunity in Japan. So I thought, why not put Danny in one of the craziest matches at Masters of Pain versus Ryuji Ito? So I told him I was doing that, and you know he said, I won't let you down. And he said, what match am I doing? And I told him it was a barbed wire trampoline. And he said, okay, let me give me maybe a week, and I'll think of something crazy to do. Well, with that, so him and Ryuji Ito, they did the barbed wire trampoline. And not too long ago, I was waiting to go out for that GCW Hall of Fame. And Danny said, come here a minute. I want you to hear something. So I walked with him a little bit. And he said, I want you to know that Connor Claxton was sitting there watching his computer. And he watched me and Ito suplex each other us into the trampoline. And Ito did the moonsault. And Connor, this is Danny telling me, he's like, and Connor's looking over at me like, have you seen this shit? This is crazy. I want to do this. Have you seen this shit? And Danny said, he just looked at him and said, are you fucking kidding me? It's me. That's me. Connor didn't even know it was him.
But that sounds about right on all accounts.
That's one thing about Danny, man. His promos, his life, everything. He always liked to make people laugh, and he always got pretty good laughs out of me.
Absolutely, 100%. Dis, when did you notice that Danny was going to be a star?
I don't know. Like, at that time, we were more so, like, friends and just, like, same level, especially when he was, like, living in Wisconsin. You know, he fucking hated it, but I love that he was so close. One time, I believe I talked him into skipping an Ian Rotten show to do a battle royal for me with bribing him with fucking booze and other wares.
but good. Like, fuck Ian Rotten. Skip every fucking Ian Rotten show there is. Fuck that guy.
But regardless, for the time, you know, it's fun to just be able to talk my friend into, like, blowing off a show to do a Rumble. I think he was only in the Rumble for 2 or 3 minutes because he was fucking lit. Another time we were to a show and he wasn't booked, but he was going to come with. So I had my cousin, he back, and then we had no room, but we fit Danny in by putting another guy in the trunk so Danny could come and get wasted at the show.
He was amazing.
Like I said, he wasn't a fan, but I fucking love that he was like 2 hours away. You know, it's always brutal when your friends fucking live super far. But, you know, he like just, for me, he turned out to be probably the greatest deathmatch wrestler from America. You know, I mean, just like all around package, you know, and he kind of gave, you know, he retired when probably could have been even the hottest even more. I'm glad he got his fucking run, you know, in that little GCW tour, you know. I think Danny Havoc legit, though, is definitely the best American deathmatch wrestler of all time.
Absolutely. That seems to be a general consensus, and it's definitely a lot of what everybody is saying, where he used to take the actual wrestling move and made it unique to death matches in such a way that it still would get the reaction from the crowd and still look nasty, like the dragon suplex that we had mentioned with the light tube behind the back.
But my matches with like Grant from CZW were probably some of the best matches of my career. And like the thing with Grant was he was like one of those guys who like always pushed for me and like kind of went to bat for me. Like I probably wouldn't even have been, I think I said this earlier, but I probably wouldn't even have been in CZW if it wasn't for Grant and pushing for me. So I owed him a lot in regards to like being my biggest supporter on the East Coast, trying to get me there. Even recently when I went out there, a big part of me wanting to go to the East Coast was to be able to hang out with him. That's like the main reason for going to.
Pondo, do you have any favorite stories about your time with Danny, about maybe things that he had done that maybe made you laugh?
Hey, just so you know, I do this thing at 10:30. It's called Walk with Pondo, but it's raining, so I am walking the bridge and talking to you at the same time. Sounds and I'm good, a fat ass, you. So I lose breath. Okay, but
The first story is the Masters of Pain. I don't know if you saw the promo, but Danny probably had the best promo because he just went through all types of carnage, but his promo was about his belt breaking and his wife who bought the belt. To me, that was awesome. And then for the Hall of Fame, he like thanked me. And I'm like, what are you thanking me for? He was like, you paved the way. You paved the way for all of us, or we wouldn't be here at this Hall of Fame. And that meant something to me that he would even say something like that.
Very true. I do.
That's probably
that.
His two biggest.
Do you have any special Danny Havoc moments that you remember?
Well, I have like,
other than, of course, him bringing you out.
A lot of our moments are like inappropriate or like don't want to divulge, so they're more personal. But just pretty much any time I got to hang with them. Like sometimes I would go to Philly early, you know, or a night before, just so I could go out to a bar or two with Grant, you know, and just hang. Like I said, for me, my biggest thing for going to the East Coast was being able to hang with one of my best bros who, you know, wasn't really coming out to the Midwest much anymore. But like match-wise, we did a singles in May, I don't know, 2000-something. That was my last match I did in CZW. Like that match was pure fucking fire. And like I haven't had a match that good, you know, since, and I probably won't again because there was just a certain chemistry I had with my friend being on the same wavelength in life or something, and just the super connection between us, where that match was just one of my all-time favorites. He was just one of my best friends, man, in the business. You know, you make friends and acquaintances, but you know, there's some people that you talk to on a pretty regular basis over a 15-year span or whatever it is. And that shit's just irreplaceable, man. Like some of the texts I have between us, you know, I'll never ever delete that stuff. That shit's super special to me now. Being nice just to like look back on my friend and the stupid shit we would talk about together, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Scotty, do you have a favorite moment or memory, live stream appropriate, with Danny?
Well, we were in Wisconsin doing a show for Luke Hadley. And I'm sure you guys saw the clip where he convinced this guy who had a donkey that would like pull around a little cart to actually take him to the ring. So the dude, because it was Drake and Grant in the main event, so they came to the ring kind of like Royal Rumble style, only in a cart that was being pulled by a donkey. And I just thought it was, I mean, obviously very unique. It's never been done before. I mean, that's just the way Grant thought. You know, what could he do to be different? What could he do to be innovative?
We all got super fucked up at that show. That was that Door County show. Everybody was wrecked. If you find a copy of that show, I was doing some commentary just fucking. But, you know, when you had us together as a group, you know, man, we were straight up party fucking animals.
Oh, yeah.
But, man. You know, those were probably the biggest partying years of my career. You know, I ain't nothing like that anymore. You know, I had times without some of good shit. Great time.
Oh, yeah.
I double death, biking, and getting fucking wasted. You know, that shit was crazy. That's, you know, there's some good stories that come out of that one. Drake, PPR, baby.
Yeah, on that same Luke Hadley show, like the night before, Luke Hadley got us all like cottages to stay in instead of like hotels.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, and we went out to the bar the night before the show, and I got super fucking hammered. I mean, to the point where I was like blackout. And there's video of me passed out on the couch, and a Necro Butcher actually stuffs fucking newspaper down my pants and lights it on fire.
You're on fire.
So, yeah. So I'm on fire, but Grant. You know, and I barely even woke up for that. So Grant like convinced Insane Lane to check my pulse and shit. You know, like he was still concerned for my safety, even though I had just been lit on fire, and he wanted to make sure I was all right. I mean,
drew blood. I remember seeing that video the day after or whatnot of the flaming ass paper or whatever the fuck that was.
Yeah, I woke up the next day with like burns on my ass. Like, what the fuck happened?
Them Luke Hadley parties.
Yeah.
What are some of your guys' favorite Danny Havoc matches?
I would have to say it was Jim Kassai. The match where I wrestled Danny. I love that match. It was solid all the way through, and I know that makes me sound conceited, but if you ever go to the Masters of Pain with me versus Danny Havoc, there wasn't a flaw in that match, but Danny really didn't flaw that much anyway.
Mm-mm. Fair. Dis?
I don't know.
My personal favorites are obviously the ones I've had with him. That one match that I've just been popping around with him and Masada where he hits him across the chest with that fucking gusset plates for the first time ever. You know, that's fucking nuts. Another thing I would like to say is a match I wish I could have seen would have been Danny Havoc and Orrin Veidt one-on-one. That match would have been fucking straight
man.
Fire. Like a super dream. You know, I was definitely something I was trying to do, obviously. But, man, for me, that match would have been fucking A+.
Yeah, absolutely. Scotty, what about you? Matches you were involved in or matches that just involved Danny and not you?
I really liked his match with Jim Kassai. I mean, that was obviously, you know, legendary. And, like, for me personally, like, he was my first opponent in Tournament of Death at TOD 6. And he was actually my last opponent at TOD 12. So he was my first and last opponent at TOD 12. And the match we had at 12 with the 444 light tubes, that's one of my favorites. And I mean, like this was saying, this and Grant were always great. I mean, Sammy and Grant, he couldn't have a bad match, man. I just
not one. No. You couldn't find one if you looked for it.
No.
Are there any other Danny Havoc memories or stories that you guys might want to bring up before we continue on to our last slate of guests?
Like I said, for me, a lot of mine are going to be like personal, not share ones because they were fucking good times and partying. But just overall, you know, like I said, in the business, you have some friends here and there, but like for me, Grant was legit one of my best brothers in the business from meeting, you know, early on in IWA Mid-South, you know, and just him being in Wisconsin where I was able to see him on a regular basis and then just always staying in contact. Like when I would be on tour with ICP, I'd always make it a point to have Grant come visit or I'd hang with him when in Philly, you know. I had him one time, I don't know if you remember that Pondo in the Electric Factory where he was my guest for the day. I don't know if you're on that tour or not. But I had him there for a couple hours, and it was just funny seeing him in that atmosphere backstage and whatnot. But he was just somebody I fucking just wanted to hang with any chance I could. So, like I said, my trips out east were based on, hey, I want to hang with Grant. So if I can make that happen, you know, fuck, that's the plan.
Yeah, and another thing about Grant, man, like, if you look at guys, like, who are doing death matches hardcore now, like, you can see his influence in a lot of guys, you know, like Alex Colon, G Raver. I mean, you can just see Grant like in those guys, you know. And like everyone's been saying, he just wanted to help everybody. He, you know, he was selfless, wanted to put everybody over, and I mean, whether he knew it or not, he was a huge influence on a lot of us.
Super influence on this whole new generation of guys, honestly. You know, anybody from the last 5 to 8 years who's super into death matches is probably greatly influenced by him in numerous different ways. Being like, you know, like Scotty, we were some of them original hybrid wrestlers, deathmatch guys who were like the wrestling deathmatch guys, you know, not just the smash and grab, you know. Drake, you know, JC, guys from that time period, we were like kind of like that first crew of fucking dudes like that. So the second, third, you know, crews that have come along, you know, they super duper like total fucking resemblances of Grant all through those guys. And that's good because it makes them all fucking better. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
100%. Pondo, do you have any last thoughts about Danny that you would like to say?
Well, this is my last thought. I'm glad Dis is on here. I'm glad Scotty is on here. I wish Devin was still on here. I just want to thank everybody who put up with my shit, who made me look good. I hope you feel like I made them look good. But Supreme and Danny, I wish I would have been able to tell them that, and I didn't. So I've been making a point to tell people who's wrestled me and helped me get over with the crowd and and all that shit. I just want to tell Diss and Scotty right now, I fucking appreciate both you guys, man.
Hey, Pondo, I've known you for like 20 years, man. I love you too. I feel the same way, you know, regardless of people's political shit or whatever, you know, like, you know, certain people, you should just keep loving them regardless, man. You know, Necro, you know, whatever, he's opinionated. But, man, he definitely needs everybody's love right now, you know. You never want to see, you know, your friends in a bad spot and then people kind of shit on them regardless. I don't care what political views people have. I just love them as a person. So I totally feel Pondo saying here, you know, everybody should just love each other in the scene. And, you know, there's not many of us fucking, you know, fuck. It's getting rough, man.
Scotty gave me one of the most biggest hits of Madman Pondo on YouTube with Pondo versus the Whore. So I got to appreciate Scotty so much.
Oh yeah, I do. The feeling is mutual, Pondo, man. That was one of my favorite matches I've ever done. I mean, I think you helped get me some exposure just from that match alone. You know, I think that did a lot for me, man, and I appreciate it.
But everybody in the deathmatch world who's gonna watch this, Slack, Tremont, fucking Corporal, any of them, any deathmatch guy out there, I want you to know, I appreciate each and every one of you, whether I wrestled you or not. Let's keep death matches alive. Let's keep the memory of Danny alive. Let's keep the memory of Supreme alive. JC Bailey, all the motherfuckers. And I want to thank you guys for letting me have time on this Danny tribute.
Absolutely, Pondo.
Yeah, you said that shit perfect, man. I love you, brother. It's been a lot of years, and there's just a lot of good brothers in the deathmatch scene. So you said that shit dead on, man. Love everybody, for real.
Gentlemen, I want to thank you all for joining us once again. Scotty, thanks for sticking around a little longer, hanging out, swapping stories, Dysfunction, Madman Pondo. Thank you guys so much.
Yeah, thanks again, guys. Everybody have a good night. Love you, Pondo. Love you, yep. Scotty.
You too. Love you guys, man.
Everybody have a good night.
Later, guys.
Later.
And we have one more slate of guests who I believe are here. I'm just waiting for them to pop up here. There's Neil.
Hey, y'all. What's cracking?
Neil, am I still referring to you as NDC for now, or are we just going Neil Cutter?
Whatever.
Neil Diamond Cutter is here, and of course, the indestructible ref of death, Mr. John Gray. How are you, gentlemen, this evening?
Good. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, I'm good.
And you guys can hear everything. You guys seem to be coming in clear. I just want to make sure we're all good, able to hear.
Yeah. Yeah. I just hope I continue to come in clear.
Yeah, yeah, right, I can see it clearly in Scotty's very strange haircut.
Here's
saying that blows my mind, Scotty. I thought you'd never cut your hair.
So what we've been doing here is we've been starting at the top with our introductions to Danny and how you met Danny and kind of stories about your first impressions of Danny. So Neil, you'd like to start with that. What was it like the first time you met Danny Havoc?
Yeah, I don't remember the exact date, but I know it was an IWA show in that shitty building in Bellevue, and Ian put like a bunch of us together in a scramble, and I think Alex Colon was in that match. I think Scotty was in it too. But like just meeting all these dudes for the first time and then seeing Danny, who one of the first death matches I ever saw was him and Devin at King of Death in the finals, where the ending they come off that big ass scaffold and destroy that table and shit. And like that, like seeing him for the first time, I was like, oh man, he's a little skinnier than I thought he would be. Holy crap, I thought he was thicker. You know? And me being the shy person I am when I first meet people at first, you know, I didn't want to step on anyone's toes, so I let everyone else kind of dictate how everything went. So unfortunately, I didn't get to like really interact with him per se. But like he was like, yeah, whatever you want, guys want to get in, like don't be shy about getting your shit in. I'm like, okay. I think I did like three moves. But like he was just such a nice dude, and afterwards he was like, hey man, you should have gotten a little bit more in, you know, that caring soul that he had. He always wanted everyone to get a little bit more in and get over a little bit more, like everyone's been saying. He wanted everyone to get over no matter what. So like that's something that really stuck with me for a very long time and still does.
And John, what was your first impression and your first time meeting Danny Havoc like?
Scotty, you may be able to help me out on this. I don't remember if Danny's at his funeral or not, or if I met him at the memorial, but it was one of the two. And I tell you, he was just super, super cool. Is Scotty Vortex still with us or no?
I see. He looks frozen to me.
He might still be in the chat. Let me see. But go on with your story, John.
I was just curious because I don't remember if it was at the funeral or the memorial, but whichever one it was, you know, Danny was just very, very kind and caring. You know, he was just one of those people. You know, he didn't want to see anybody hurting. Very articulate. I too was surprised at his size because he looked bigger on the videos that I had seen. Just like Drake, I thought Drake was taller. You know, and you know, like when I met him, he's just this short little, you know, he's like my height, and I was like, whoa, you know. But yeah, I just can't remember if it was at the funeral or at the memorial, but it was one of those two that I met him for the first time.
I would just like to point out that both Scotty Vortex and Larry Legend both said that this has been very therapeutic, and it's very good for us to keep the memories alive and keep the happiness alive. We've been sad for so many days over this, and now we're able to kind of celebrate. And John, Scotty Vortex said it was the memorial, by the way.
Okay. I couldn't think of Scotty.
So, Neil, we're also just telling our favorite Danny Havoc stories, whether it was moments you had with him, whether you saw him do something in a match and it made you curse to yourself. So why don't you tell us some of your favorite moments with Danny Havoc?
Well, like, I only had like three encounters with him. I think we crossed paths maybe four times, but only three of them have stuck into my head. And the second one that I have is we're at Carnage Cup 7. And fucking, he just got done having his match with Tremont. And he's standing there, and he's got a piece of, like, jagged glass like this stuck in his back. And I walk up, and I'm just like, ee. And in his dry sense of humor, he kind of looks back at me, and he's like, you really think that's something you want to have a guy hear when he has glass sticking out of him? And I'm just like, oh, no, it doesn't look that deep. It looks fine. Like, no, it's a, you know, I start backpedaling real hard, you know. And I was just – they pulled it out, and – they said they ended up going to the hospital for it, so who knows how true that is. But, you know, like, just anytime I saw Danny, he was always real warm and friendly and willing to give a listening ear. The last time I saw him was at, I think it was Double Death Wars for H2O, when me and the Hooligans and all them came out.
I'm just getting notifications about that in my Facebook memories. That was Subterranean Violence number 5.
That okay, yeah. And like we came out, and like I wasn't expecting Danny to remember me at all because it's been years. I technically retired and came back, and like I walked up and I was like, hey, Danny, it's been a long time, man. I'm happy to see you. And he just kind of turns and looks down on me, and he's just like, hey, Neil, what's up? And wraps his arm around me and gives me a big ass hug. He's like, I missed you, man. And I'm like, I'm surprised you even remember me. Like, I was a little shithead last time. But we got to the back, and I was holding my chest because Brandon Kirk ended up kicking me really hard in the chest. Like, I've never been kicked that hard in the sternum before in my life. My hands, right? Well, we had them duct taped to the rope, so, you know, you know, shit happens. I get to the back and I have my hands above my head and I'm just like, breathing hard because I'm like, fuck, that hurt. He walks over and he's like, Kurt kicked you in the chest? And I was like, yeah. He's like, fucking Kurt.
John, before I let you tell a couple of your Danny Havoc stories, I actually want to bring up an interesting fact that you and I actually both worked on Danny Havoc's last match in the state of West Virginia. And I don't think a lot of people know about that, but I think we should say that here. So tell us a couple of your favorites. Tell us a couple of your favorite stories.
That was with Marcus Crane.
Yeah, that was Marcus. That
match with Marcus Crane.
Yeah. Lumberjacks. That was a really, really fun.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun.
Fun event. But I also know that you knew him.
Oh, yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
I'm sorry. I also know that you knew him for a little while as well, so I'm sure you have a lot of memories of certain things.
I got to work with Danny at like Insanity Pro a couple of times. He came down to Destination One Wrestling, which was a little company Rick Reddy was running out of the Charlestown, New Albany area of Indiana there for a little while. And him and Drake did a seminar once, and I'm, you know, I'm in there, and I'm, me and a lot of people don't know me, Scotty, Drake, Zaya, we all, you know, kind of, I spent some time at the Rage Dojo with Isaiah at the very beginning of our career. So, you know, we all kind of came from the same cloth. So Drake brought Danny in to do some stuff, on a show, and I got in on the seminar to try to, you know, learn some whatever. And they spent like an hour and a half trying to teach me how to do a quarter roll. And the one thing I took away from that was Danny has the patience of a horse, because he never like got upset or mad. Didn't matter how many times I landed on my face. He was like, come on, John Gray, get up. Let's do it again, you know. And he was just very positive about it. And I would like to say that after an hour and a half, I did finally get it. And I kept my shoes on. Because they kept falling off, but it was it was a lot of fun, man. Danny was a character. He had a way of teaching you and you know, giving you criticism without, you know, bringing you down at the same time. You know, he would build you up with his critiques, and just, you know, teach you, you know, and take moments and make them teachable moments. To him, there was not a waste of movement, and you just couldn't. He was just like almost in a walking encyclopedia, I think is the best way to put it. I mean, just a walking wrestling encyclopedia, and probably the most well-spoken wrestler I've ever been around in my life.
100%. 100%. He was using words in promos that I didn't even know existed at the time. That's he would just take these words out of, and it was almost Shakespearean how he would find these words and figure out the best way to put them in a sentence that would not only like get his point across for the match, but he would insult and compliment his opponent at the same time. So that way, when the promo was over, his opponent would just got to be like, well, now, hey. And it always landed exactly how it was supposed to. What are some of your favorite Danny Havoc matches? Let's start with Neil.
One of them that's up there because it inspired me to really be in it, an innovator as much as I could, was the King of Death with Danny and Devin from 08, mm-hmm. I think it was. And the other one was him and Masada, of course, which I didn't even know that was the first gusset plate match. Like, I had no idea. Like, that's one thing that I really like about when sharing stories is that, like, they're sharing pictures of how he would build these matches and stuff like that and come up with the ideas and such. And, like, if you know me, you know, Scotty, you know, I've asked you plenty of times about matches and shit, about, like, okay, I'm trying to do a Carpenter death match. What can we do in that? Like, you know, I'm always trying to think of new shit to kind of do and be different from everybody. And like, that's one thing I never really knew about Danny is that he did the same kind of shit. You know, I've got designs drawn up for certain weapons and stuff like that. And I had no idea that he did things like that. So it's really touching to hear that, you know, like, despite the fact that we didn't know each other, you know, all that well, like, we still have a lot more similarities than not. You know, I love Viking history and all that kind of jazz, and I love that everyone's sharing all these stories because it just really goes to show, like, how much he truly loved and how much of an innovator he really was. The second match was him and Sammy Callahan in Cage of Death. That was a brutal fucking match.
That was a really good match. Ladies and gentlemen.
Go ahead.
Joining the Danny Havoc tribute right now is Corporal Robinson. Corp, can you hear us?
I saw him. He was disappeared.
Yeah.
I saw him a second ago.
Probably hit the old button. Knocked himself out. Scotty's still frozen on the screen, from what I can see.
Yeah, he's still frozen on my screen, too. So,
one more quick Danny Havoc story before we have to side off. Neil, why don't you give us a funny Danny Havoc memory you have of maybe seeing him wrestle or seeing a promo?
Oh, God. So many of them.
There are a lot.
Like, probably in a nutshell, I would have to say probably just seeing him in that goofy fro, because it was just so, like, look at this white boy with the big ass fro. Like, that, in a nutshell, explained, like, his humor. Like, just very dry, just this is who I am, you know, kind of stuff. There's Corp.
Corp, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you guys, man. I can hear all y'all, man. What's happening, fellas? What's
up, man? All right, what's happening, Corp? Corp, what we're doing here is we are celebrating the memory of the late, great Danny Havoc. So if you have a Danny Havoc story that you would like to tell, or a couple, just go for it. Let us know what you have to say,
bro. Yeah, I got a few, man. You know what I'm saying? Just, you know, the one thing about Danny, man, Danny was one of the best people ever. You know what I'm saying? Now, they go, he goes way past just one of the boys in wrestling-wise. Like, Danny gave a fuck about everything he did. He gave a shit about the, you know, the gimmicks and weapons he was in. He always one of them guys who wanted to make sure everybody was safe. He always wanted to make sure everybody was okay. He always made sure the refs were good. You know what I'm saying? Danny was one of them people, man, that he gave a fuck about everything he did. And he put his heart and soul into everything he did. I met that kid, first time I met him. Him and Dysfunction, we was at the House of Hardcore in Charlestown, Indiana. And we had IWA Mid-South. And this was right when the building just started blowing up big. And me and Mitch was in this big-ass feud. And I think it was him and Dysfunction that showed up, because him and Dys rode together a lot. Him and Dysfunction rode together a whole hell of a lot, and we're up and down. And Danny came in. I don't know if it was the Pool of Leeches match. It was one of the fucking stupid matches me and Mitch were doing. But I came in the back, and Danny's like, "Court, pleasure to meet you. I'm Danny Havoc. Like, nice to meet you, blah blah." He goes, "Why in the fuck did you do that?" I was like, "What do you mean?" He said, "Why in the fuck did you do that without thinking it through?" I said, "What do you mean?" He goes, "Man," he goes, "you are one of the best at doing this." He said, "But goddamn it, promise me from now on you're gonna think shit through when you go through there." And you know that stuck with me. All the crazy matches I did after that, I think Danny Havoc on the mat is I thought everything through. I would look at the weapons we were landing in. I would make sure my opponents were a lot safer. All because of my first impression with Danny was, man, think that shit through, man, before you hurt yourself. Because he gave a fuck about me more than I gave a fuck about me. And that's just the kind of guy Danny was. He was the first person when I got out of jail for VOW, did the VOW show, and that was the last show I got to be with him on. And he was the first person that came running to me, man. And he said, "Corp, I love you, buddy. Thank God you're out, man." He goes, "You're one of the old fuckers that are still left in this thing, still doing it right." He goes, "I love you and I hope to see you soon." He said, "But my fucking ass is retired." And we ended up having a beer. It was me and Masada and him. And let's see, there was a few of us out there. Devin Moore. It was Dev was out there and a few of us, you know what I'm saying? We're all out there. And the best fucking thing about Danny gave a fuck about everybody. You know, he gave a fuck about his profession. He gave a fuck about what he did when he came out. He gave a fuck about the fans, and he everything that man did, he gave a fuck about.
That's absolutely correct. Danny was definitely one of the great minds, not just in deathmatch wrestling, but in professional wrestling. We're going to sign off in just a little bit here, but I think we can do one more little thing from EG is about Danny Havoc. We're going to start with Corp and work our way down from Corp to John to Neil, and then we'll go from there. So, Corp, any last things you want to say about Danny?
Look, Danny, you're going to be well missed. We love you. We miss you. You're one of the best men that's ever been in this business. You will never be replaced. There's nobody that's ever going to be like you, brother. I just hope you're up there with that beautiful wife of yours, man. And I hope you're happy now, man. Rest in peace, brother. I love you, and we're going to miss you every fucking day, man.
John?
I don't know if I can add anything to that. I mean, Danny was a hell of a guy, hell of a talent, somebody that we're all going to miss. I was, you know, blessed to be able to work with him numerous times. I will miss his very random and sporadic and very rare emails and texts that he sent that I usually had to call my lawyer and ask for definitions of words for. other than that, man, dang, Valhalla, brother.
Neil?
I'm going to kind of reiterate what Pondo threw out there. Like, you know, Danny left his mark on a lot of us. Like, you can see it in G-Raver, Marcus Crane, Schlack, me, Cologne. You know, the list goes on and on of guys that he probably touched. And, like, unbeknownst to him, touched a lot of people he's never met or barely met. Like, he barely met me, but he left such an impression on me with his whole career. And just to add with that point, like, all the deathmatch guys out there, like, if any of you guys need to get a hold of me, get a hold of me. Like, whatever you need. Like, if you need help with something, talk or get through something, ideas for something, like, just give me a holler. Like, I'm more than happy to talk to you and be willing to give you a listening ear if need be, whether it's good times or bad times, whatever. You know, it's one of the reasons I love the deathmatch community, because it's unlike any other community I've been a part of. Everyone cares about each other for the most part. Everybody wants each other to be safe and just, you know, fucking, I love all you guys, man. Whether we got heat or not, I fucking love you guys. And as far as Danny goes, right, like, the holler for sure, man. We'll all see you one day, brother.
Absolutely. And on behalf of Corp and John and Neil, Pondo, Dis, Scotty Vortex, Devin Moore, DJ Hyde, Connor Claxton, everybody who had a part in commenting on this, on participating in this, on putting this together. Thank you also to the admins of the group for putting this whole thing together. We thank you for joining us at this celebration of Danny Havoc's life. I'm not going to promote anything else that's happening on the page. I'm not going to say anything that's coming up. I think we're just going to keep it to this, and we thank you all for watching.
Love you guys.
Love you all.
Love you, Corp.
My name is Danny Havoc. You probably never heard of me, but I just had a really swell match in there, and I'm bleeding a little bit, and but that's the way shit goes.
Along with mine, would have fucking joined up with the CZW crew.
That was a long trip.
You're fucking CZW.
Beach and every highway.
it my way.
I have made my name as a deathmatch wrestler. I came up in the Midwest and I moved all the way out to the East Coast for one fucking reason: to join Combat Zone Wrestling, where the blood flows and we push the fucking limits. I want to be exactly who I fucking am. Danny Havoc, the deathmatch drunkard. We're violent, that's what we do. That's why we're CZW. Otherwise, we'd just be some other promotion. Drew Gulak challenged Danny Havoc to a no-rope barbed wire match, and in doing so made the biggest mistake of his fucking life.
We are the hardest partying, ass-kickingest collection of white trash sons of bitches that CZW has ever seen. We are the nation of intoxication. We are gimmicked up and gangster as fuck. We are a roving deathmatch rock and roll gang.
I had my dream match against my hero, Saru the Crazy Monkey, June Kasai. I beat that crazy son of a bitch.